Good morning to everybody. My name is Cina Conforti, and I thank you very much for listening to the presentation of my master thesis project, which I performed at the University of Bologna within the framework of the International Master of Science in Marine Biological Resources. So during my project, I actually dealt with the identification of specimens belonging to two genera of decapods. One is the Galatea genus, and the other one is the Ewallus genus. But now, before to begin, why did I decide to focus on decapods? Well, firstly, decapods constitute a great diversity of benthic invertebrates, especially on the Mediterranean continental shelf and slope. But many of them also have a high commercial value. Let's think, for example, to the squat lobsters that many of us likes to eat. Furthermore, their larvae constitute up to 90% of total zooplankton biomass, thus playing a fundamental role as prey of carnivore species, but also as consumers of smaller phytoplankton. Thus, they determine the stability of benthic and of fishery biology. And finally, the number of studies on population biology and on ecology of decapods increased consistently in the last decades. However, when we work with decapods, we have to pay attention because a high degree of crypticity is recorded within this group of taxa. And for instance, species belonging to the genus Galatea show a high phenotypic similarity between them, meaning that their distinction is possible only based on very subtle morphological differences. And the same applies also to species of the genus Ewallus. And that's why I decided to particularly focus on these two genera. But now, what are cryptic species and why it's important to account for them? Two cryptic species are two species that are identical at morphological level. So if you take two individuals and you observe that aesthetically they are the same, you might classify them under the same species. However, if you use a different identification approach than the morphological one, let's say DNA, and you plot two organisms on a phylogenetic tree, you might see that they are very far away from each other, meaning that they could belong to two distinct species. And in this case, the two species, because they are identical aesthetically, they are considered cryptic. And if you don't take into account crypticity, you might have species misidentification, which can lead to several consequences on ecological studies. For instance, the over or underestimation of species risk. And that's why in my project, I firstly aimed at correctly identify specimens of the Galatea and Ewallus genera using an integrative taxonomic approach. So exploiting morphological characters and DNA barcoding for species identification. And DNA barcoding is a molecular technique that uses a short DNA sequence from a standardized region in the genome as a molecular diagnostic for species level identification. Secondly, I tried to reveal the potential presence of crypticity within both genera using a species delimitation procedure known as ABGD. And ABGD is a software that sorts sequences of DNA into hypothetical species based on the barcoding app. And finally, I tried to solve phylogenetic relationships within both genera using my sequence records as well as records downloaded from public databases. So, I won't speak too much regarding the sampling since I did not perform it by myself, but thank you to those people that collected the specimens for me. Anyway, specimens were collected across three locations in the Mediterranean Sea within the framework of the CIMOR project. What I actually did back in the lab was firstly to morphologically identify specimens of Galatea and Ewallus using a stereomicroscope as well as identification keys provided by the literature. Later, I sequenced the mitochondrial cytochrome C oxidase 1 gene of each previously morphologically identified individual, and I chose the CO1 gene as genetic marker for species identification, essentially for two main reasons. Firstly, it is the most used one. There is a higher number of reference records available for comparison. And secondly, its rate of evolution is considered rapid enough to distinguish between separate species, but also between phylogeographic group within a single species. And as you might know or not, what I did was to extract the genome separately from each individual. I amplified it using PCR. Then the sequencing of the gene was performed using a Sanger technique and then a bit of quality check and bioinformatics to obtain two data sets like this one, where each row represents the sequence of each individual. Now, what did I do with these sequences? Firstly, I uploaded them on the Barcode of Life data system identification engine, which is a library that provides you a match of your query sequence with a reference records with a species present in this library. Secondly, I upload the whole data set on this ABGD software, which provides you information regarding the number of hypothetical species within your data set, as well as information regarding which sequence, which organism belong to which species. And finally, I downloaded several sequences from public databases such as BOLD and GeneBank of the genera Galatea and the Walrus to build phylogenetic trees, and I built both maximum likelihood phylogenetic trees as well as Bayesian inference phylogenetic. But now, what did I obtain finally? Regarding the Galatea genus, the results are very interesting, so I will present them using this haplotype network based on CO1 sequences, where each circle indicates a unique haplotype in your dataset, so a unique sequence. The size of the circles indicate how many identical sequences you have in your dataset, and the distance between the circles indicate the genetic distance, so how many nucleotide differences there are between sequences. And as you can see, morphological identification allowed me to distinguish between two Galatea species. One is the Galatea squamifera in light gray, and the other one is the Galatea intermedia in dark gray. Now, the results obtained by DNA identification using BOLD identification engine showed slightly different results. In the sense that it allowed me that there are some specimens that are indeed Galatea squamifera, but some others, which I also identified as Galatea squamifera, they do not show any match with Galatea squamifera reference records on BOLD. And similarly, those specimens which I identified morphologically as Galatea intermedia, they did not show any match with Galatea reference records on BOLD, even if there are some present in the library. And even more interesting is the fact that ABGD software suggested to me the existence of three distinct species within my dataset, and not only two as suggested by morphological identification. And these results are supported also by the phylogenetic reconstruction. Here I'm showing you the Bayesian phylogenetic tree, but the maximum likelihood tree showed the same topology. Here I colored those clades that contain my specimens, and I color-coded them based on the results obtained by ABGD. And I did not color those reference records which I downloaded from public databases. And as you might see here, reference record falling within group one, which I morphologically and using BOLD identified as Galatea squamifera, they indeed fell within the same clade of Galatea squamifera reference record, confirming their identity. However, those specimens which I morphologically identified as Galatea squamifera here of group 2, they do not fall within the same clade, but they build a sister clade of it, suggesting the existence of a still undescribed species cryptic to Galatea squamifera. And the same occurs for those specimens which I morphologically identified as Galatea intermedia, but in reality, they do not fall within the same clade of Galatea intermedia reference record, but they build a sister clade of it, suggesting the existence of a new undescribed species cryptic to Galatea intermedia. Now, these were the results regarding the Galatea genus, and moving on, the results regarding the Ewallus genus, I have to be honest, the results were not so clear because of controversial results obtained by morphological identification and molecular identification. Unfortunately, I have not been able to assign an accurate identity to none of the specimens. Anyway, morphological identification allowed me to recognize three distinct species within my dataset: Ewallus puseolus in yellow, Ewallus crankii in reddish, and Ewallus occultus in greenish. However, considering the fact that the haplotype network is based on CO1 sequences, and hypothesizing that my morphological results are correct, we can see that probably the CO1 gene is not a good genetic marker to distinguish between these species of Ewallus, because otherwise the color should have been segregated, right? Second things, the BOLD identification engine show slightly different results than the morphological identification, and additionally, those specimens here, which I highlighted in yellow, they show the same similarity with three distinct species simultaneously. And it is impossible that one organism is at the same time a distinct species, right? So this suggests us that probably there have been some misidentification in the BOLD database. And even more interesting is the fact that ABGD software suggested the existence of four distinct species within my dataset, and not of only three as suggested by morphological identification. Now, the phylogenetic tree here, I always show you the Bayesian phylogenetic tree, and I would like to highlight that the tree built using maximum likelihood method is exactly the same. And what I really want to show you by this tree are those reference records which I downloaded, and here I highlighted in red. So here there is a Taurolus cranchi, which is a synonym of Aewalus cranchi, which fell within the same clade of Aewalus puseolus. And this kind of dubious. And similarly, the last clade here at the bottom is constituted by three distinct species, Aewalus occultus, Puseolus, and Ecranchi. And this is kind of dubious as well. So there are two explanations for this pattern. Firstly, the CO1 is not suitable to distinguish between these Aewalus species. Or second, there have been some species misidentifications on both. But I believe the second option to be more probable, especially because the CO1 resulted suitable to distinguish at least between some of Aewalus species, such as Aewalus fabrici, Aewalus gammardi, or Aewalus macedentus, right? So this is why I obtained this unclearness in the results regarding the Aewalus specimens. But now, to summarize a bit everything, within the Galatea genus, the morphological approach allowed me to recognize only between two species, Galatea squamifera and Galatea intermedia, while the DNA-based identification allowed me to confirm only the existence of Galatea squamifera. And interestingly, ABGD suggested the existence of three hypothetical species within my dataset, not of only two, indicating that probably morphological identification leads to underestimation of species richness because of crypticity within my dataset. And this can be confirmed partially by the phylogenetic tree, which suggests the existence of two yet undescribed species, one cryptic to Galatea intermedia and the other one cryptic to Galatea squamifera. Now, the results regarding the Aewalus genus, both morphological approach and the molecular-based identification allowed me to recognize three species within my dataset, Aewalus cranchi, Aewalus occultus, and Aewalus puseolus. However, the coupling between the morphological results and the haplotype network suggests that the CO1 is not suitable to distinguish between these Aewalus species, while the results obtained by the bold identification engine suggest that probably there have been some misidentifications on the database. Anyway, the ABGD software suggested the existence of four hypothetical species within my dataset, more species than those that I visualized and I recognized at morphological, using the morphological approach, suggesting potential presence of crypticity also within this genus. And the phylogenetic tree, interestingly, said that probably some misidentifications on bold occur and that at least the CO1 is suitable to distinguish between some Aewalus species, as previously showed also by other studies. So, to conclude briefly, the CO1 resulted suitable to distinguish between the Galatea species within my dataset, and it suggested the existence of two yet undescribed cryptic species. However, unfortunately, it remains still unclear if the CO1 is suitable or not to distinguish between these Aewalus species. This unclearness in the results might be due to the unsuitability of the genetic marker, but also to misidentifications on the bold database, as well as by misidentification due to morphological traits. And anyway, the use of ABGD suggests more species than those identified using a morphological approach, suggesting the potential presence of crypticity also within my dataset of the Aewalus genus. And anyway, the use of distinct genetic markers, both nuclear and mitochondrial, as well as the use of a higher number of samples and a reference record would allow me to clarify these results. These were things that I was planning to do, but unfortunately the lockdown situation did not allow me to go further with this study. And finally, to conclude, I would like to remember that since I'm using an integrative taxonomic approach, also considering the biology, ecology, and behavior of species, as well as performing experimental tests, for example, on the reproduction between these specimens, would allow me to confirm or neglect the existence of crypticity within these two genera. So, with this presentation, I thank you very much for your attention. I hope that you enjoy it and that you might have learned something. I thank you for the attention again, and I would like to thank you also those people that supported me and that allowed me to work on the project. So thank you very much, and I